What's going on, guys? The Comics Kid 2099 here to examine an issue of the X-Men. Today, I'm examining X-Men issue 57. We have two stories here. The first story is written by Roy Thomas with penciling by Neil Adams, inking by Tom Palmer, and lettering by Sam Rosen. The second story is a quick explanation of how Jean Grey's powers work. This is written by Linda Feit with penciling by Werner Roth and inking by Sam Granger. Much like the previous issue, we do not have a letterer credited on this backup story, so I don't know who lettered this backup story. The first story in this issue, do you guys remember Lorna Dane? Because this issue finally does. She was introduced like 5 or 7 issues ago, something like that. It wasn't the previous storyline with the Living Pharaoh, but it was a story before that with Mesmero and Magneto and Cyclops dressing up as Eric the Red. It was that storyline that introduced Polaris, although I don't think the series is calling her that yet, but I'm going to call her that because it's easier for me to remember her codename. She was introduced there, and then at the end of that storyline, you would be forgiven for thinking that she is the newest member of the X-Men, but then we don't see or hear anything about her whenever we're introduced to Alex, the next newest member of the X-Men, Alex being Cyclops' younger brother. Now we get to see that Polaris is living in Manhattan, much closer to the X-Men's old headquarters, which I don't think the X-Men are operating out of the school anymore. If you remember, Professor X, he died fighting Grotesque the Subhuman, and then Agent Duncan of the FBI, Fred or Amos Duncan, whatever his name is, he comes and tells the X-Men, hey, you guys need to split up, you'll be much safer that way, and then they did that for about 2 issues, and then they came back together when Mesmero and Magneto were kidnapping Lorna Dane. And so now she is kidnapped by a Sentinel, and then meanwhile, the X-Men are still in Egypt, and they have Professor Abdul, that is the civilian identity of the Living Pharaoh, who kidnapped Alex and tried to kill him so that he could absorb all of the cosmic rays that Alex was absorbing, which powered his mutant abilities. And with Alex out of the way, he could transform into this giant living monolith, and then when Alex is still alive, he can't do that. And Alex was able to escape from the glass coffin thing that the Living Pharaoh had put him in, and then the Egyptian police come, and it turns out that they know Professor Abdul, so he tries to blame the destruction of this temple on Alex, which it is Alex's fault, but of course he's not going to tell the Egyptian police that he kidnapped Alex. He's saying, well, this young guy, he destroyed that temple, and the Egyptian police, they believe him, so the X-Men fight back a little bit, and then they escape, and Alex is able to separate himself from the X-Men. I'm not really sure how he's able to do this, because it looks like it's just miles and miles of desert, but then we see that Alex is in this little cliff ravine type thing, so I guess it's not all miles of desert, but that would have really been a good time to show like a really far off wide shot of the scene so that we could kind of see there's more stuff than just desert, because in this fight scene it looks like it's just desert and then the ruins of this temple that Alex destroyed. But Alex is able to separate himself from the X-Men because he is afraid that he's going to hurt someone with his abilities. At one point he even says, yeah, my brother, he's got these mutant abilities, but he's never had to struggle with anything like I have. And I'm thinking, come on, man, Cyclops has had these powers for years, I would say at least 5 years, and he's never able to take off his goggles or his visor, and you have had these powers for like 10 minutes, and you claim that you're not able to touch anyone, but you haven't tested that theory. We know that whenever he concentrates, he can blast out an energy beam from his hands, but we don't know if that means that he can never touch another human being again. But he is kind of angsting about his powers again, and then a Sentinel captures him. And then meanwhile, the X-Men, they split up. Jean and Scott are going to look for, and I think Beast, they are going to look for Beast goes with Iceman because they were going to call Polaris, and they see that her apartment has been ransacked by the Sentinel. So Iceman and Beast are going to go and see if they can find Polaris. Meanwhile, Angel, Jean, and Scott are going to stay in Egypt and look for Alex. And meanwhile, Beast and Iceman, they get to Polaris's apartment, and the police are like hiding behind the door, I guess, waiting for someone to come in. And when Iceman and Beast come in, the police, they're like, hey, we're going to arrest you guys. Beast gets knocked out the window. window, and there's this really cool silent page of Beast falling out of the window with the panels arranged very interestingly. Like I said, I really like Neil Adams's art in these issues. Very dynamic. This page layout is not something that you would have seen even 5 issues ago, and I really like that he's taking some risks with the page layout here. This is something that I feel like they probably would have fought against a little bit just a year earlier, but I like that he's saying, hey, we don't have to have everything look quite so geometrical with just squares as far as the panels. We can do some interesting stuff with the panel layout. But anyway, Iceman and Beast, they are managed to go back to Scott's apartment, and they turn on the TV and see Larry Trask is allied with a man named Judge Chalmers, and they are talking about how mutants are evil and they pose a threat to humanity. And we find out that Larry Trask was involved with the creation of the Sentinels when his father was still alive, and then he went to college, and that was the day that his father died. And so this also says that this particular issue takes place 3 years after the last time we saw the Sentinels. And if I'm not mistaken, that is also in real time how long it's been since we last saw the Sentinels. So at this point, it seems like all the characters at Marvel are kind of aging in normal real time. I know it was John Byrne who first came up with the idea of a sliding timeline, and that would have been late 70s, early 80s when he came up with that idea. At this point, I guess everyone working at Marvel was still probably thinking, like, in 5 years, we may not even be writing comic books anymore, so who cares if we keep these characters the same age or if we let them age as we get older? They probably weren't too concerned with that at this time. So it has, in story, been 3 years since Bolivar Trask died, and the Sentinels was the last time we saw them. And I would like to know, where has Larry Trask been this whole time? I guess it takes a lot of capital to build a bunch of 20-foot Sentinels like this. Also, if you remember, in issue 16 of this series, we found out that this big giant crystal on some building in the middle of the city, that somehow was the key to defeating the Sentinels. And I called it back then that the next time we were going to see Sentinels, they were not going to mention that crystal thing, and sure enough, they don't, but the X-Men themselves have not fought any Sentinels yet. But it looks like a Sentinel is about to sneak up on Beast and Iceman. So you would think once they see that the Sentinels are back in action, they would say, hey, let's get Warren to go and get that crystal thing in New York City, and then we can use that and it'll destroy the Sentinels. But I don't think they're going to do that. But anyway, this is looking like it's going to be a good storyline, the return of some characters who were kind of difficult for the X-Men to defeat. This was a 3-part storyline that introduced the Sentinels the last time, and at that time, that was crazy. Usually you just had 1- and 2-part stories, but the Sentinels needed 3 parts, and I remember it really didn't need to be 3 parts long, but it was 3 parts long. But the Sentinels, in theory, could be a huge threat to the X-Men, and now they don't have their mentor and leader to help them, because he did use his telepathy against the Sentinels somehow, but they don't have him here to help them anymore, so this will be interesting. Also, I am curious, how would the X-Men go about teaching a mutant to control their abilities? Because Professor X had the Danger Room built, and then he would say, you know, Angel, you're not doing good enough, or Iceman, stop goofing around, or something like that. But Professor X, in his will, he did leave the school to Cyclops and the rest of the X-Men. And in theory, that means finding other mutants and helping them control their abilities, just like Professor X helped them control their abilities. And then you've got Polaris. She has abilities, and she's even practicing with her abilities here in this issue, and she's not doing very well. Why haven't the X-Men been helping her? Why aren't they letting her use the Danger Room? Try and get her powers under control. You have Havoc here. He's worrying that he's going to kill someone. All you have to do is have the X-Men say, look, all of us were terrified when our mutant abilities first manifested, and then we were able to get it under control. You can do the same thing. We haven't really seen them evolve into the teacher role that I kind of expected when Professor X left them the school and wanted them to continue doing the X-Men like he was doing. So far, they've been fighting a lot of bad guys, which is expected, but you don't really get to see them embracing what Professor X was doing with the school. So I would like to see some more of that, but I don't think we're going to get any more of that. So far, I'm totally on board with the Sentinel storyline. I'm enjoying this, really liking the direction this is going. I did think that the Living Monolith, Living Pharaoh storyline was a little silly. It started off like, okay, what's going on here? These guys dressed up like pharaohs or kidnapping this long-lost brother we'd never heard of before, and then it just kept getting weirder with no explanation for any of the weird. There was a little bit of explanation for Havoc getting kidnapped, but nothing that was really a satisfying conclusion, in my opinion. Also, I don't know if we're ever going to see the Living Pharaoh again, or if we do, it's going to be like sometime in the 90s before we see him again. I vaguely remember when the late 90s, Alex Summers was accidentally jaunted to an alternate reality where lots of weird stuff was going on. Beast had been mutated into this aquatic-type creature. Angel, he was all dark and broody, looked like he was a member of KISS, and then Madeline Pryor was there, and she was a good guy. She had a kid with that universe's version of Alex. While he was in that reality, I remember Polaris thinking, well, Alex is still out there somewhere because we haven't heard back from the Living Monolith, and he would have become the Living Monolith if Alex was dead or wasn't here to absorb cosmic rays. And I don't remember what the explanation was for why we hadn't seen him do that, but I think he is going to show up again, but not in any comics that I am going to be examining, because I don't remember reading anything else with this guy. So the last the X-Men see him, he's hanging out with the Egyptian police and free to kidnap Alex again sometime in the future, but he never does. So anyway, that's about it for this part of the issue. Then we get a 5-page storyline basically telling us how Jean Grey's powers work. And this is about as pointless as how does the Beast's powers work. No one was really asking how do Beast's powers work. So instead of telling us how his powers work, basically they said, well, he likes to read philosophy and he likes science. And it wasn't really about his powers. It was just here's some of the Beast's hobbies. And again, I don't think anyone was really asking how Jean's powers work. We know how telekinesis works. We know how telepathy works. And she has both, and we see her using them here, but we don't really learn anything new. What is interesting here is that Linda Fight, she was an employee at Marvel, but I don't know what her position was. There's a little note that says, since this backup feature is about a woman, we figured it would be good to have a woman write this. And I do think that that's interesting, but I don't think that you needed to comment on it. I don't think you needed to say, look at us, we're patting ourselves on the back because a woman is writing this comic. I do believe this is the first instance of a woman working on the book, although now that I think about it, I think there was a letterer who was a woman at one point on the series, but I don't remember for sure. But anyway, Linda Fight, if you don't know who that is, at one time, I don't know what her position was, but it says she was an ex-Marvel staffer, but in the early 70s, she wrote the series The Claws of the Cat. And that featured a character who eventually became Tigra in The Avengers. But that series did not last long, only 4 issues. And basically, it was a similar situation to what we have here, where it's like, okay, this is a lady character, so let's get a woman to write the series. And apparently, Linda Fight wasn't too impressed with the character. She didn't think anything of this character, but she was glad to have the work. That series did not last long. And then, not so much a career move for her, but later she married Herb Trimp, the late Herb Trimp, who had a pretty lengthy run on the Hulk series in the 70s, I believe. But that was about all I could find out about Linda Fight. But this backup story, it's not great, and I don't think that that's her fault, because back in the 60s, they did the Marvel method, where instead of a writer writing out a full-blown script, the artist would kind of draw out some stuff, and then the writer would script it out. This was specifically when Stan Lee was writing most of the stuff at Marvel, and he didn't have time to write a full script for every comic, so he would just come up with a plot. Sometimes he would co-plot it with the artist. They might say, like, okay, Aunt May gets kidnapped by the Green Goblin, and then Spider-Man has to go and look for her, and then they fight a little bit. And that might be the extent of the co-plotting they did, and then the artist would draw 22 pages of that, and then Stan Lee would come back in and script it after it was all finished. So I don't know if Marvel Method was being done here specifically, since Stan Lee is not working on any part of this. He's listed as the editor, but I don't really know how much he was actually involved with the creation of this issue. So I don't know if Werner Roth drew a whole bunch of pages of Jean using her abilities, and then Linda Fight came in and just created the words, or if she was involved with, okay, on this page, Jean Grey is going to be making an apple pie, and she's going to be sweeping dirt out with her telekinesis, and it's all very sexist. That's why it's not great, and that's why I'm not sure if we can blame Linda Fight for that, or if we have to blame Werner Roth for that. I don't know whose idea it was. Let's do an entire page of Jean making an apple pie and then doing housework. That's just really sexist and weird. You would not do that if it was the Angel or Iceman. You wouldn't do that if it was a male character who had telekinesis and he was using his abilities to make apple pie. And Jean even says, I'm not very domestic, but when I do make an apple pie, I have an advantage. And I just thought that was really bizarre. But anyway, we didn't really learn that much about Jean's abilities here. We already knew how her powers worked, but I guess it would feel very weird if everyone else in the X-Men had an origin issue and Jean didn't. Even Professor X, who's not really a field guy, we saw some backup stuff many issues ago back in the teen issues. We saw how he lost his legs, and we did get a little bit of him in the first backup issue whenever he decided to go and meet Fred Duncan at the FBI. So even Professor X gets a backup issue, then Jean should probably get one too. Like I said, we saw her join the X-Men in the very first issue, so we were never going to get a backup story showing that again, but I feel like this is the closest we're going to get to a Jean issue. Let's show her using her powers, even though we didn't really need that, in my opinion. So, next issue, I don't know if we're going to be getting any more backup stuff. I vaguely remember seeing something about how Angel has, like, hollow bones and kind of like a bird. I don't know if that's going to be happening here, or if that was in, like, a handbook of the Marvel Universe or something. Here's how his powers work, and that happens there. I don't know. But anyway, that's about it for this issue. Let's consider this one examined.